This video is a guide for the Reti Gambit, which is a pretty awesome way to deal with the French defense. A lot of people don't like playing any sort of main line against the French defense because black stays very solid, but at the same time, it always seems like you're the one defending your center, and just black has a lot of resources to attack your center in this sort of setup, which is why a lot of people look for ways to beat the French defense without entering mainline theory, and this is where the Reti Gambit could be very powerful. It is now playing the move b3, and after they go d5, playing the move bishop to b2, giving away the center pawn, but then continuing knight c3 and claiming that you have so much development that you're going to end up either winning back the pawn, or if they try to hold on for it, winning even more. Now there's two ways to hold on to the pawn other than the move queen d4, but the move queen d4 is a bit awkward. You don't want to develop your queen so early. The knight will be able to kick it, and also, you know, it's lining up the queen on this diagonal with the bishop, and although there might not be anything you can do about it right now, it's still something that seems a bit awkward for black to do, which is why there's really only two major ways on defending the pawn. If they don't defend the pawn, say they play something like this, well then you can take, and now you have a powerful bishop, a nice central knight, very, very easy development. I mean, you have a beautiful position. So let's start by knight f6, which is definitely the more natural continuation. Now against the move knight f6, you're going to play queen e2. It might seem a bit awkward, you know, blocking your bishop, but the thing to notice here is that you're looking to castle queenside. This knight already doesn't have the best square on f3, so it's okay to kind of, you know, hold off on developing these pieces and prioritize castling long. Now, you're of course attacking this pawn, and again, you know, if they don't do anything about it, you know, so for example, let's say they play knight c6, well then you can take, and, you know, let's say after takes takes, again, you have a very powerful bishop, a nice central queen, you can castle, develop very easily, a beautiful position indeed. In fact, even pinning the knight seems quite good. Let's suppose, however, instead that they try to defend it. So one of the options is queen d4. That's actually one of the only moves that looks to defend this pawn. And now you can simply castle, claiming that your bishop is now defended, and, you know, you're going to have ideas, you know, of these to open up this bishop. And if they try to develop and castle themselves, well, suddenly you can go, for example, g4, saying that after they castle, you can attack here. You can also fianchetto your bishop. But, you know, for example, g5, the knight has to come back. You can now take here, attacking the queen, opening up this bishop. I mean, this is absolutely perfect. After the queen moves as well, you know, you can continue launching an attack. White is completely dominating in this position, which is why, you know, it doesn't make sense for them to hold on to the pawn after the move queen e2, so they might just go for something like bishop e7, looking to castle quickly. And, you know, against that, you can simply take, they castle, you castle, and, you know, let's say they take. Again, your bishop is powerful. You have quite easy development, and even if they don't take, by the way, I mean, you can at some point move the queen and then develop again easily, or even fianchetto this one as well, and you have good chances to attack. You know, they're going to maybe try to counterattack you on this side of the board. At some point, you can play king to b1 to hold your king more in the center of the queen side, and then you can counterattack and launch an attack as well on the other side of the board. So this is giving you basically some pretty good chances. So that's kind of what happens after knight f6. You're either going to win back the pawn, or like we what I showed you in this variation with queen d4, you're going to have a massive attack. Now, what if they instead defend with f5? Now, quickly, this might seem really bad because of this diagonal, but it's not actually as bad as it seems. In fact, the engine says this is the best move, because the truth is, black is not going to look to castle here. They're going to castle long as well. This diagonal then won't be that big of a problem, and right now it's not a problem because they can simply play g6, and actually after this move here, g6, you might be thinking, oh, look at this, but then they can actually occupy this diagonal. It's still an important thing to keep in mind that you can try to play this move. You know, for example, if they trade this bishop, or if this bishop already was developed, then maybe this would be worth it, because then they couldn't occupy this diagonal. You know, so after g6, queen moves back, then this diagonal would be a very powerful diagonal for you. But, you know, as the situation is right now, where they can fianchetto the bishop immediately, I'm not sure how much, you know, worth this has. Which is why, instead, I would recommend playing the move, you know, d3 here. And after they take, let's say, you can take with your bishop. Let's say they develop their knight. Again, you can try something like this, but again, they'll simply match your bishop here. Which is why you can simply continue knight f3. And yes, you are down a pawn, but you have a lot of development for it. All of your minor pieces are out. This pawn is a backwards isolated pawn that you're going to be able to try to attack with your rooks and queen at some point. You know, so for example, bishop e7, queen to e2, knight to f6, long castles lining up this diagonal. So let's say they try to stop that diagonal, this file. So let's say they try to block it with bishop to d7, but then comes bishop c4, and you can see that pressure is just being built here. You're going to win back this pawn with some interest as well, because you just have such a dominating position. So overall, definitely don't be scared of sacrificing the pawn for longer than you might want to you know, sacrifice the pawn for, because while they have that extra pawn, they have the responsibility of holding on to that pawn, and sometimes that leads them into making bad moves. And so going backwards, you know, after the move d3 and takes, you're going to have a very easy game with really smooth development. Your rooks get to the center and you can start to attack. What if they don't take, you might be asking? You know, maybe they play a move like knight f6, hoping that after takes, you know, takes, they keep this pawn structure and everything's good. But the truth is, you know, let's say they trade queens first. The truth is, you're just going to take back. And in the end, the reality is, they have two isolated doubled pawns. You have a powerful bishop, another one on the way, whether or not you fianchetto it or not. And then this knight can come into the game. You have control over this diagonal. So that one pawn, you're definitely going to win it back. They already, you know, these two pawns kind of act like one pawn because they're on the same file. So they can't really, you know, push together. So you already aren't even kind of down material in a way, but even if you were considering this to be down a pawn, you're just going to win it back so easily. Once you castle, put your rook on this file here, truly you're going to win back the pawn, and again, you're probably going to have some interest on that pawn, and you're going to win some more as well. And then, you know, again, if they don't trade the queens, you know, let's say they take with the knight, well, then you could even have a better setup, because after king takes, here, you know, you could even castle, and you've even won some time as well, and you can start to attack this super hard to defend, in fact, in this position, even undefendable pawn right here. So, as you kind of see from this opening, there's not much risk in this gambit, and you know, some gambits have more risk than others. This one really doesn't have much risk, because the pawn on e4, the thing to notice about it, it's really hard to defend. And they can try to defend as long as they can, but as you saw from some lines, if they try to hold on to it, you're going to be able to castle and pressure them along these files. So really low-risk gambit. Your pieces develop super smoothly in this gambit, which is kind of ironic, because it might seem like they're taking away pieces, squares for your pieces to develop to, but it's not the case at all, and this knight will either be able to develop here once you win back the pawn, or as I showed in other cases, this g3 square is a real nice square for the knight. So hopefully this video helped you guys learn this gambit. I think it's one of the best ways to play against the French, especially, you know, if you don't like going into that main line theory, you know, where in the end you have this d4 pawn that it's your responsibility to defend. You're kind of flipping the tables here and saying that this time you're going to have an extra pawn, but it's going to be your responsibility to defend it, and that could cause black to get into a very bad position very quickly. Thank you guys for watching this video. Subscribe if you're new around here and want more videos like these, and I'll see you guys next time. Peace out.